Good morning. Apologies for being slightly late. It's one of those things, really. It's good to see the room so incredibly full today. It's really nice to see everybody here. I'm not noting any visitors or prayer requests, but if there are, you're more than welcome. And if there's prayer requests, just let Kevin know. They go out an email, and that helps us keep on top of that. I will be presiding today, obviously, and the songs will be led by Nick. David has the reading, and that will come from Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 to the end of the chapter. The Lord's table will be brought to us by Robert, and Emmanuel has the preaching today. Refreshments following worship today will be organised by Joy. I think that's mostly everything for just now. Please switch off your phones or silence the electronic devices so that they do not disrupt the service. It is quite an echoey room, so things like that can become quite distracting. Similarly, if you have any small children, make sure that you can take them to the back. There's a cry room, there's a lot more space in beside the ladies' toilet as well. That just makes it easier to sell any unhappy children, or any disruptive children. But yes, I think that is for just now. Once again, it's good to see you all here today. Our opening hymn will be 671. But first, we will have a prayer. Heavenly Father, as we come before you today on the first day of the week, it is our prayer that we are focused on being in the moment with you. In this moment together, as we sing songs of worship, hear words of praise, and learn things about you, your Son, your Holy Spirit, and the Word. And we pray that we can be attentive and ready to listen, ready to worship you with our whole hearts, forgetting all the distractions of the world. We cannot totally forget the world because they need you, Lord, and we need to be your lights in this world. So we pray that we can take what we get from here and take it to the world. Most of all, we thank you for Jesus. He is the founder and perfecter of our faith. He is everything we strive to be and everything we cannot be. And it is because of that he came and died. We are just so incredibly grateful for that act of love. So it's through Jesus that we pray. Amen. So please go standing for our opening hymn, 671.
There's a royal banner given for display to the soldiers of the King. As an ensign fair we lift it up today.
Disappear, and across the world shall
mentioned at the beginning. Our reading today comes from the book of Revelation, chapter 3, verses 14 to 22, which is the end of the chapter. And David will bring us that reading just now.
Revelation 3, reading from verse 14. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So that because thou art lukewarm, and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich, and increased with goods, and have need of nothing. And knowest not that thou art wretched, and miserable, and poor, and blind, and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. And anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. And many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him, and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame, and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches.
Thank you, David. Our next hymn will be number 48. Anyway, with Jesus, and then we will sing another hymn after that. But please remain seated for the singing of this hymn.
Anywhere with Jesus, I can sell some books. Anywhere with Jesus, I can safely go. Anywhere he leads me in this world below. Anywhere without him, dearest joys would fade. Anywhere with Jesus, I am not afraid. Christ has blessings on my head, I am made.
I thought this morning all the songs that Mark has chosen that kind of touch on, maybe not all the verses of each hymn, but there's a kind of an ongoing theme. Probably know what that means. Okay. Those of us that are old enough, you probably see on TV the sign of victory, you know, after the Second World War. Think all about what the word victory means. An act of defeating
an enemy, and that could be, you know, various things, which I'll briefly touch on. In war, for example, whoever wins, they might be in the right or wrong. At the end of time, God will be the judge of that. In sport, those that are victorious, whether it's a team or a single athlete, runner, they may be victorious and they win a cup or a medal. In health, you all know your own health, you may have your own battles with your own health. You may have overcome battles with your health. That's a victory as well. If you happen to be in court for any reason, not saying anyone here could be guilty, but you may win your case, in which case you'd see yourself as being victorious. In the Bible, David, young David and Goliath in the battle, a small stone conquered the giant Goliath. And you would have seen that as being a great victory of a small boy conquering and killing Goliath. And then how about the Israelites in Egypt? They were enslaved for over 430 years. And yet, you know, God saw them victorious when he took them out of Egypt. Although they thought they were safe, the army of the Egyptians was close behind, but God still saw them through to peace and their own land when the Egyptians were drowned in the sea. So in order to gain victory, there's going to be a winner, but also a loser. Someone or something will be defeated. Victory can be costly. You can see, you know, the destruction over in the Far East, for example. Whoever's right or who's wrong, I'm not going to judge. But you can see the devastation in some of the cities and the loss of life when you see it on the television. So although there might be a victory in that scenario, it can also leave a scar. Victory over a health problem can also leave scars as well. Colin and I could probably speak about that this morning. But what about the greatest victory? You know, people in the world today looking at history may think, you know, the great wars were great victories. More local skirmishes may be seen as great victories in that part of your country. But what about if the world, you know, realised the greatest victory of all time was in the Bible? Christ's victory over Satan, over death. A couple of songs sprang to mind that I probably could have sung. So I'll read one verse from one. It was one of Dave's favourite. It's, "Low in the grave he lay, Jesus my Saviour, waiting the coming day, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. Hallelujah, Christ arose." So you can imagine if you were standing at the cross, looking up at Christ and the two thieves. I'm sure the thieves' family, as well as Christ's mum and the disciples, there would have been sadness, thinking this may be the end. But as we know, he rose victorious, and he showed the disciples, he proved to doubting Thomas, for example, the scars on his hands. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, "But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labour is not in vain." Sometimes you think, you know, fighting a battle is in vain. You're not getting anywhere, they're stalemate. But eventually someone is going to become victorious. And John writes in 1 John 5, verse 4, "For everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. So man, us in this room today, the world outside, we have no other way of gaining victory over death without Christ shedding his blood. The writers in the books of the New Testament, Paul, John and Peter, say the following in their own books. Paul first, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. Then John says, but if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Christ, of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. And then Peter says that we're not saved by things that are perishable, but saved by the precious blood of Christ. So without him, we have no victory. Over at Livingston last night, one of the choruses that wasn't sung, that Mark did say he hadn't chosen, was the chorus title, Without Him. So it's quite apt to just read this again. Without him, I could do nothing. Without him, I'd surely fail. Without him, I would be drifting like a ship without a sail. Without him, I would be dying. Without him, I'd be enslaved. Without him, life would be worthless. But with Jesus, thank God, I'm saved. Jesus, do you know him today? So please don't turn him away. Jesus, without him, how lost we would be. You know, as we go through our lives, as we get older, even younger, we may see the finishing line. Do we give up? We want to go on to the end. The runner, why would they want to give up when they see the end, that finishing tape? So the writer of Hebrews says we should fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Which leads us into the song that we'll sing. That victory that we're going to remind us of, the blood that Christ shed while we're here today. Battles in the past, they have remembrances. So today we are remembering the battle that Christ won over Satan. And that was through his death on the cross. So we heard an old story, how our Saviour came from glory, how he gave his life from Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning, and I repented of my sins and won the victory. If you're able to, we'll stand in this song and also further the prayer.
I heard an old story, how the Saviour came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning, then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Saviour forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing blood revealing, and he made the way to walk again and cause the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. I then obeyed his blessed commands and gained the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has story, and some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior, forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
We give thanks to the Lord and Father, we thank you for drawing us to this place where we can meet together as a family, to give thanks, to praise you in song and prayer, and to be reminded once more, Father, of that great victory. You know our struggles in life, Father, our battles with our health, with the world, and we pray that we can look to you for strength, for guidance, so that you can lead us through those times and that we can see the winning line. At this time, Father, we're reminded of the great sacrifice and the victory that your Son, Christ, and over death and over Satan by giving his life in Calvary. This time, Father, we're mindful of the bread which represents his body, which suffered the agony of nails being hammered through his hands and feet and having his side pierced, knowing, Father, that you took the sins of the world and nailed them to that cross, that we can have our sins cleansed and washed away. Father, give us our faith in our lives, Father, to be more faithful as we struggle with our own battles, knowing that we have a prize that awaits us, the crown of life, if we stay true to you in this life. Bless us, Father, we thank you for Jesus, and we ask all these things through his precious name.
Amen. Amen.
Lord, we thank you for the mercy that you show us through the sacrifice of Jesus. We know that he died to save us, Lord, and he also showed us the perfect way to live when he walked this earth, Lord, showing mercy to those who didn't deserve it, Lord. We can't heal the sick and do the miracles that he did, but we can show love and point people towards Jesus, the only way that they can be saved, Lord. Help us to always be grateful for that sacrifice, and when we're going through troubles in our life, to realize what he did for us and the hope that lies in putting our trust in you through your Son. So partake of this cup, help us to think of the blood that he shed on the cross, that heals our spiritual wounds, Lord, and gives us hope that we would not otherwise have. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
So it's back to Mark.
Today is 180, God is love. And that victory that Robert spoke about could only have been conceived of and planned for because God is love, and he is a God of love, and it is through that love that Christ came. So please be standing for the singing of this hymn.
Come, let us all unite to sing, God is love. Let them that let their praises ring, God is love. Let every soul from sin awake, each in his heart sweet music make, and sing with us for before, were written
were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scripture might have hope. Things that were written before were written for our learning. This is making reference to the old writings. And today, we'll be learning from one of the characters of the Old Testament. I title it Jonah, a man running away from, with, and ahead of God. And we'll be running through the four chapters of the book of Jonah. So, I'm going to read. Jonah, I'll start from chapter 1. So, I quickly run through the four chapters. It's a story that most of us are familiar with, but I will read, and after that, I'll just have a brief talk. We draw the lessons that are there to learn. Now, the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. Then the mariners were afraid, and every man cried out to his God and threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But Jonah had gone down into the lowest part of the ship, had lain down, and was fast asleep. So the captain came to him and said to him, "What do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us, so that we may not perish." And they said to one another, "Come, let us cast lots, that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us." So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Then they said to him, "Please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble upon us? What is your occupation, and where do you come from? What is your country, and of what people are you?" So he said to them, "I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, "Why have you done this?" For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. Then they said to him, "What shall we do to you, that the sea may be calm for us?" For the sea was growing more tempestuous. And he said to them, "Pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will become calm for you, for I know that this great tempest is because of me." Nevertheless, the men roared hard to return to land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. Therefore, they cried out to the Lord and said, "We pray, O Lord, please do not let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood. For you, O Lord, have done it as it pleased you." So they picked up Jonah and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and offered a sacrifice to the Lord, and took vows. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. Like I said, it's going to be a long reading, so we move to chapter 2, just to refresh our memories of everything that happened to Jonah. So chapter 2 tells us about him finding his way back to God. Then Jonah prayed, for the Lord is God, from the fish belly. And he said, I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction. And he answered me, out of the belly of the shell I cried, and you heard my voice. For you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the flood surrounding me. All your billows and your waves passed over me. Then I said, I have been cast out of your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple. The waters surrounded me, even to my soul. The deep closed around me, weeds were wrapped around my head. I went down to the moorings of the mountains. The earth with its vast closed behind me forever. Yet you have brought up my life from the pit, O Lord my God. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer went up to you into your holy temple. Those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy. But I will sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay what I have vowed. So the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto dry land. And chapter 3 tells us of how he ran with God. Now, the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and preach to it the message that I tell you. So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now, Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, a three-day journey in extent. And Jonah began to enter the city on the first day's walk. Then he cried out and said, yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. The people of Nineveh believed. So the people of Nineveh believed God, proclaimed a fast, and put on sackcloth, from the greatest to the least of them. Then word came to the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne and laid aside his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. And he caused it to be proclaimed and published throughout Nineveh by the decree of the king and the nobles, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink water. But let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily to God. Yes, let everyone turn from his evil way and from the violence that is in his hand. Who can tell if God will turn and relent and turn away from his fierce anger so that we may not perish? Then God saw their works, that they turned from their evil way, and God relented from the disaster that he had said he would bring upon them. He did not do it. The last chapter of the book, where we see Jonah running ahead of God. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he became angry. So he prayed to the Lord and said, ha, Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in my country? Therefore, I fled previously to Tarshish, for I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm. Therefore, now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. Then the Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? So Jonah went out of the city and sat on the east side of the city. There he made himself a shelter and sat under it in the shade, till he might see what would become of the city. And the Lord God prepared a plant and made it come up over Jonah, that it might be shade for his head, to deliver him from the misery. So Jonah was very grateful for the plant. But as morning dawned the next day, God prepared a worm, and it so damaged the plant that it withered. And it happened, when the sun arose, that God prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun beat on Jonah's head, so that he grew faint. Then he wished death for himself, and said, it is better for me to die than to live. Then God said to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about the plant? And he said, it is right for me to be angry, even to death. But the Lord said, you have had pity on the plant, for which you have not labored, nor made it grow, which came up in the night and perished in the night. And should I not pity Nineveh, that great city, in which are more than 120,000 persons, who cannot discern between their right and their left, and much livestock? All right. So, as I have said, chapter 1 described a man who had received a direct instruction from God on what he needed to do, but he would not do it. He disobeyed and ran away from God. Then trouble came, crisis came. He brought calamity upon himself and the people around him. Then, when trouble came, he realized himself, found his way back to God. He found his way back to God. He did what God had commanded him to do. And he had peace. Peace was restored into his life. And shortly after that, because he wanted to control the outcome of his obedience to God, then he was displeased again. He was unhappy again. To the extent that he wished he could just die. He wished that his life would just come, to an end. So, if we break this down to ourselves as Christians, when God gives us instructions, if we fail to obey, it brings nothing but calamity. It brings problems into our lives. And when we return to Him, when we do His will, the only primary concern that we should have as Christians is doing His will. And we leave the rest in His hands. We do not have control over what God does. He does what pleases Him. Any attempt for us to think what God is doing is not right, or the outcome of our obedience to Him is not what we had expected, the reward that we are getting is not what we had anticipated, then problem comes. And that will be us running ahead of God. So if we look at the life of Jonah, chapter 1, his life was in crisis, his life was miserable, his life was in danger, everything, and he even used that to affect those that were with him. But he realized himself, and peace was restored. He walked with God, and in chapter 1 and 2, all was well with him. And then you get to chapter 4 again. He became unhappy. As I have said over and over again, as Christians, the Word of God is meant to guide us to eternal life. That is the primary purpose of God's Word. For the secondary purpose is for us to live a happy, fulfilled, and peaceful life here on earth if we follow His word to the letter. The failure to do this is is what brings crisis. It's what brings problems. It's the only thing, you know, that brings unhappiness. So let us learn from Jonah. Let's learn not to run away from God by disobeying him. Let's learn to run with him through our obedience. And let's learn not to run ahead of him by trying to control the outcome of our obedience to God. Paul, in his writing to the Christians at Corinth, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 25, I'm going to read. 1 Corinthians 1, 25. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. Paul is not in any way here suggesting that God is foolish. But my understanding of this verse of the Bible is when God has said, do it this way, a man thinks that way is not good enough. It means man is considering himself to be wiser than God. And God, in this sense, is foolish. But Paul is saying, despite the wisdom that we think we have as men, that which God has said, that which God has commanded, which we are judged to be foolish, is still wiser than our own wisdom. So when God has given a clear instruction, when God has said, go this way, do it this way, no matter how foolish or stupid it appears to us, as believers in Christ, we are expected to follow without questioning. And that is when we are running with him. Any other thing will amount to running away from or ahead of him. And on those two extremes, there cannot be peace. There cannot be joy. There cannot be anything good. Psalm 1, verses 1 to 3 says, Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. So, a man whose delight is in God's words, we can see how his life would be. A man who runs or walks with God is the one who follows his words and is going to be like a tree planted by the river. Winter or summer, it's always green. The season does not affect it. So our lives shall be if we walk with God. If the only thing that makes us happy, if the only thing that delights us is his words and commandments. Matthew chapter 6 verse 33 is a popular passage of the Bible. Christ was teaching his disciples to desist from worry. He was telling them that by being worried, they cannot even add a cubit to their stature. So, no point getting worried over anything at all. And in conclusion, he told them what to do. He told them the solution to the problem. And he said, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. So, here he's talking about setting up priorities. Is our priority to please God? Is it to do his will? It's like, you know, trying to assemble a jigsaw. You need to, there are some things you need to get right, that you need to fix, and all of that, the whole picture comes into place. But most of the time, we tend to pursue or run after the things that does not really matter, because we are using our own wisdom. We are relying on our own wisdom and strength. And because as a result of that, we become just like Jonah, who is running away from God at some point, or running ahead of him. So the safest spot for us to be is to be in obedience to God. Psalm 119, verse 105. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. That is what the word of God is. It's a light and it's a lamp. It shows us the way. It guides us. And if we follow the word of God, our life will be free from darkness. Our path will be clear. We'll be able to see clearly ahead of us where we are going. And I'm going to close by the words of one of our hymns. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there is no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. The summary is in just two words. Trust God and obey him. Do not run away from him or ahead of him like Noah did. But let us learn to run with him through our trust in his words and obedience to his will. And our lives will be in order. We will be happy here on earth, and even in the life beyond, we will be with him forever. Thank you for your attention, brother.
Thank you, Emmanuel. Tempted as I am to change the song to Trust and Obey, I think I will stick with 350. Because even as Emmanuel was talking about the fact that we can run ahead of God or lag behind or stand beside him, if we're holding Jesus' hand, then he has the ability to guide us better. So please be standing for the singing of this hymn and remain standing.
As I travel through this pilgrim land, there is a friend who walks with me. Leads me safely through the sinking sand, it is the Christ of Calvary. This will be my prayer, dear Lord, each day to help me do the best I can. For I need thy light to guide me day and night. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. that I may reach the golden strand. There's no other friend on whom I can depend. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Yes, I need thee every hour. Through this vast, this pilgrim land, protect me by thy saving power. Hear my plea, my feeble.
Before God. Father in heaven, as we bow before you at this close of our worship time, the worship that we have together, we pray that this worship doesn't cease when we leave the building. We pray that we continue to live lives of worship throughout the week. We pray that this has been rejuvenating to our hearts, our minds, and our souls, so that we can be lights to the world, that we can take the good news of Jesus Christ to them. We pray for those who are unable to be with us, whether that be through ill health, work, or any other means that interrupts their ability to join together with us, because it is good to be together. Father, we also ask that we have blessings as we leave and go into the world, as we go into our day-to-day lives, where we will find stresses and strains and trials that we may not believe we can overcome, but we need to remember that with you we can overcome them. You are our guide. We pray that we can follow you diligently. We thank you for Jesus and his sacrifice, for it is the most wonderful gift, the greatest act of love. And it's through Jesus that we pray. Amen. Please be seated just for a few closing announcements. Once again, it is good to see so many of you here. If you are going to be worshipping with us regularly, I believe there's a sheet you can fill in that kind of lets us know more about you. I don't know if it's anywhere in the building as of yet.
On the back table.
On the back table. So if you plan to be with us long term, please fill it out just so we get to know you better. Yes, it's good to be here today. First thing, there will not be a fellowship meal next week. It's been postponed. Is that next week or whenever?
It was due to be next week.
Okay.
Robert was saying we
could get a
caterer. Yeah. So we've had to postpone that, but there will be one. Don't worry. So next week, Robert will be presiding and song reading. I will be bringing the reading. Hopefully, I can speak better then. It'll be from Revelation chapter 4. Simeon has the Lord's table, and Michael will be preaching. And Robert and Karen also have the refreshments next week, I think. It doesn't say who's on the clinic. Do we know who's on the clinic?
I was going to check that.
I should have the email that Kevin sends out somewhere. Bear with me. Next week is what? The 21st. It is Simeon. Alrighty. Some events just to keep in mind going into the next few months. We have our joint meetings with Kirkcaldy on the 1st to the 3rd of March, and the speaker will be Daniel Chapman. And the theme will be pointless. Is that how you would say that?
I think so, yeah.
The theme is pointless with a question mark. I believe I have a sneak preview of his lessons, and they're very good, so I would encourage everyone to get here if they can, and also get to Kirkcaldy if you can. Looks like Kirkcaldy's the Friday night,
yeah,
and then it'll be here Saturday and Sunday, but it'll be Sunday during the day. There's also the devotional evenings that I've been sort of doing the rounds through East Kilbride, Castlemilk, Livingston and Kirkcaldy. Keep an eye on the email. That'll tell you when and where. We are hosting on April the 13th. So again, it would be very, very, very good if we could sort of come along to that and just enhance it. I don't have anything else. Anyone else have anything else? Cool. Well, refreshments shall be ready shortly. Stay around and fellowship again if you can. Thanks very much.